Where's everyone going? Bingo?
So it's finally happened. Ever since the remake of Resident Evil 3 came out, everyone was asking, when are they going to do Resident Evil 4? And here we are. Resident Evil 4 has finally been confirmed to be getting the remake treatment for March, just like Resident Evil 2 and 3 before it. At the same event, we also got confirmation of The Last of Us also getting a remake, which sparked some controversy online. This got me in the mood to talk about these two games and the industry's obsession with video game remakes in general, as well as the positives and negatives to remaking a game at all.
Damn.
But before we delve into that, how about you stop me from remaking your face off the ground by hitting that subscribe button? Come on, you're not doing anything else today, really. Well, you can take time to hit subscribe. This is gonna help us create more content if more people watch it, so, all right? Okay, thank you. So why do companies remake games? Isn't it obvious? They want money. I don't blame them. I guess it's easy to cash in on nostalgia and all.
This feels oddly familiar.
There's many types of video game remakes, all of varying quality. You have games like Shadow of the Colossus remake or the Crash Bandicoot N-Sane trilogy, which don't actually add any real improvements, and are more trying to bring the visual quality up to modern standards, which basically means, hey, let's increase the polygon count. Okay, looks good, let's move on. These are my personal least favourite types of remakes. I don't think either the Shadow of the Colossus or the Crash remakes look as good as their original counterparts. There's more that goes into a game than just making the graphics better. The people who were in charge of those games back in the day actually had a vision on how they wanted those games to look.
We want the players to enjoy the scenery as they travel through the game. That was our biggest aim when creating the landscape.
There's essentially the hero, the young boy, and the heroine. And the third character is the horse. The goal is for the hero to restore life to the heroine. They are the three main characters of the game.
Especially in the case of Shadow of the Colossus, which is such a beautiful game, and still is on the PS4. I know this is a subjective point, but looking at the footage of the PS2 original versus the PS4 remake, the PS2 version has such a dreamlike feel to it, with its use of bloom and fog to cover up draw distance, but it added to the atmosphere of the game and the emotions it was trying to evoke out of you. The long horse rides between boss battles were so great with these qualities, it truly was beautiful, and while the PS4 version is by no means bad and has some amazing visuals in of its own, it just doesn't evoke the same kind of feeling, and I feel like the original vision was lost somewhat.
So when we take on a game that has Shadow's prestige, a lot of responsibility comes with it that you can't just brush off. This is a classic. There's no denying what it is in people's minds in the space of games, and that we had to make it as great as people remember it being all over again.
One of our biggest challenges has been staying true to the original atmosphere and environment and making sure that we maintain that while also increasing the graphical fidelity and visual quality of the levels.
The new design of Wanda shows a lot less expression than the PS2 original, and the sky looks just like a normal sky when compared to the original PS2 version, which was a great mix of purple and green, which added to the strange atmosphere. In regards to Crash, there's a lot of realistic looking environments that do not look good next to the cartoon characters in this game. They just clash so much. I can't believe the amount of praise this got as one of the greatest remakes of all time, because it's actually one of the worst. Unlike Shadow of the Colossus, which I think is actually a pretty good way to experience it, even if I think the original is better, the Crash remakes I'd recommend people avoid, just because these games look terrible when put next to the titles that are over two decades old. They also ruin the hitbox, which adds to some bullshit difficulty, and in a game like Crash 1, you need all the help you can get. There are examples of this type of remake being done well, however. I think the Spyro remakes did an excellent job of updating the original.
I think I smell a barbecue.
Making certain gameplay styles a lot more bearable and keeping the cartoon look of the originals and bringing that over to a new audience.
What I mean is, I always believed in you, Spyro.
You gotta believe.
These games are beautiful, and it's no wonder Toys for Bob were selected for Crash 4, because compare Crash 4 to Insane Trilogy and tell me which one has the better art direction to you. The Klonoa remakes are another example of trying to carry over the original style whilst updating it. These genuinely look really cool, and I'm glad that these games are getting the attention again. Seriously, if you want more Klonoa games, purchase the remakes, because Namco Bandai said that's the only way we're getting more Klonoa games, and they did a terrible job of advertising it, so... Thank you. There are also games that just can't fully be labelled as remakes, but are definitely more than your simple remasters. These include games such as Nier Replicant and Mass Effect Legendary Edition, which both include a ton of great gameplay additions and improve the combat, and in the case of both, make them a ton more bearable. The original Mass Effect has such terrible gameplay, it is just not satisfying to play. And while Mass Effect 1 hasn't been brought up to modern standards for third-person shooters, I let someone who'd never played these games before go through it, and they had no problems beating the game, which goes to show how much less terrible it actually is, even if it's still not very fun. But other improvements include bug fixes and problems with the original version of Mass Effect 2, where the Paragon and Renegade system was broken, not allowing you to play a good mix of both Renegade and Paragon, as you may have missed out on some of the best conversation choices.
I've got nothing more to say to you.
How about goodbye?
Which reduced roleplay options heavily.
I'm Commander Shepard, and this is my favorite store on the Citadel.
Now, the system is a lot more lenient, so a Shepard that wants to choose to play both a Paragon and Renegade options, it's a lot more viable in this game. So what do you do when you think the original game won't work for modern audiences, but you still want to bring that game to a new audience? Well, you go down the route of building the game from the ground up with an overhaul to the original design. This is usually where the most inspired remakes come from. The best examples I can think off the top of my head are both the Resident Evil 1 and 2 remakes for different reasons. Now, it should be clear that even though I would personally class these as remakes, a lot of people like to class these more as reimaginings, as while they're both carrying over the basic premise, there's been a massive overhaul to both of these games compared to the original, in a ton of ways rather than just graphical. So when Resident Evil first came into the scene in 1996, it changed the industry when it came to the survival horror genre. It legit created an entire genre of video game in of itself. For the time, this stuff really was scary. FMV close-ups of zombies, showing details not really shown often in games from this era, as well as scripted jump scares like the dogs jumping through the windows in the hallways after you had already let your guard down. The game itself was directed by Shinji Mikami, legit one of my favourite video game directors of all time. If you really want to know how great he was, he didn't just change the gaming medium once with Resident Evil 1, but again with Resident Evil 4, inspiring third-person shooters for years to come. However, innovative doesn't really age well. I mean, technically games don't really age, it's society that changes on our expectations from the medium. But let's make one thing clear. Resident Evil 1, for as good as a game as it is, and I truly mean that, it's goofy as hell, extremely so.
This is really beautiful.
And hey, a lot of people love that about the entire series. I know I do.
It's a monster!
It's part of the charm. But for the survival horror genre, like, let's be honest, the tone can be kind of jarring for the type of game this is meant to be. And this isn't even an opinion in hindsight. By 2002, gaming had come so far in the 6 years since the original Resident Evil came out that the likes of Silent Hill 2 and Fatal Frame had made Resident Evil look kind of like a comedy in comparison. Heck, there's reviews from the game in 1996 that shows criticism towards the voice acting and terrible dialogue, so it's not like it was something that people didn't realize even at the time. And I know it's overdone to talk about it, but come on guys. The director's cut of the game would send anyone into hysterical laughter with songs like this. The original Resident Evil 1 soundtrack still has some bangers though. I think all of this adds to Resident Evil 1 as a great time capsule for the era. But as a game, is Resident Evil 1 the cream of the crop for the survival horror genre? Honestly, I can't say it is. Hold on though, what is that in the distance? Is that the Resident Evil 1 remake? Now this game, This is the game that all survival horror games need to take notes from. So what makes the Resident Evil 1 remake so great? Well, it actually justifies its own existence. Resident Evil 1 needed a remake to capture its full potential. It didn't age like a fine wine, in fact, it was aging by 2002, whereas the remake is a way more timeless an experience, for a number of reasons, and Capcom know this. They didn't re-remake Resident Evil 1, they went for 2 instead. Why? Because the Resident Evil 1 remake is the most perfect recreation of a game ever, and they knew they weren't going to top that. When they re-released the game for HD consoles, it went to critical acclaim because people got to experience the game again and remember how good it was. Firstly, the graphical step up from the 5th and the 6th generation of gaming is really significant. The characters actually have faces for one, and there's an opportunity for more detailed models and lighting. There's something that makes me take OG Resident Evil 1 less seriously when everything is so brightly lit. Like, damn, I'm glad the residents are dead so they can't see their electricity bill.
It's like Blackpool Illuminations up here.
But the remake is so much more atmospheric, both with more fitting music and its excellent lighting. The game looks gorgeous and the use of more subdued lighting actually adds to the horror. It's simple, dark scary, light not scary. This alone is enough to justify the remake for me. This is also one of the few video game remakes that I can think of to be led by the same director as the original. Shinji Mikami clearly didn't want to make the same game twice, so he added in new content that wasn't in the original, like Lisa Trevor, and changed the tone from the original to be a lot less silly. It still has some of that.
You gotta love Barry.
I mean, I can never take Wesker's design seriously when he's always rocking shades, no matter how cool it makes him look, but overall this game can still be considered scary, whereas the original, whilst having its moments, is hard to find scary anymore. The Lisa Trevor storyline in general is one of the darkest things to show up in Resident Evil, and I still think it's scarier in concept alone than anything that came out after from the same series. There was also quality of life changes like the ability to play without tank controls, and whilst I'll always play survival horror games like this with fixed camera angles with tank controls because I prefer my controls not being reset every time the camera shifts, I understand why people don't like them, and it's nice that they add the options for people who hate that type of control scheme and would prefer something more simplified. Overall, the Resident Evil remake is the definitive way to play the game. It's a masterpiece of a game in a series with about 3 games I'd probably label as masterpieces: Resident Evil Remake 1, Resident Evil Remake 2, and Resident Evil 4. And is among the best survival horror games of all time. The Resident Evil 2 remake is similar in that it overhauled the original game, but it took even more liberties than the original Resident Evil 1 remake. It does a lot of the same things that remake does, such as the more mature tone, more fleshed out scenes, and a graphical overhaul, but its biggest and most impressive change is taking the original design and translating it over from a fixed camera survival horror game to an over the shoulder third person shooter horror, and it works surprisingly very well. It's honestly one of the most impressive video game remakes I've ever witnessed. It really is a testament to the team at Capcom for making the transition from the two styles so smooth. While I have my personal gripes with it, like the original music being nowhere near as good as the godly soundtrack of the original Resident Evil 2, and parts of that original game being cut out for the remake, it still is one of the best survival horror games you can play, especially since they made Mr. X an unstoppable and more persistent monster than he ever was before. I'm also inclined to mention the remake of the original Half-Life, which I haven't played myself but has been praised to high heaven from many a fans, including my colleague Monotilla, so I'll let them talk about why Black Mesa is such a great remake of the original.
Initially, I was going to give a big history of Half-Life and Black Mesa here, but you've probably heard it before. Long story short though, Half-Life was groundbreaking with regards to its first-person gameplay and narrative that keeps the player in control of the character at all time. But with the release of Half-Life 2 and a slightly dodgy final chapter, it was clear that a few things could be improved about the original game. So in 2005, a group of fans got together to remake the game in Half-Life 2's Source Engine, rather than the straight port that Valve themselves did, which is playable on Steam to this day. The game finally fully released in 2020 and is a bit divisive in the community. On the one hand, it does breathe some new life into a game that visually was a bit dated by 2004, introducing a new final act and fixing some pacing issues with that one level. But it does also introduce some changes to level layouts and narrative cues that had raised a few eyebrows, But on the whole, I'd say this is the best way to play the first Half-Life game. The pros far exceed the cons, and it's just a blast to play. So take it from me, the voice you're hearing right now, that this is the game for you. Even if you don't like FPS games, the narrative, characters, and world building are second to none, and I'd argue an FPS didn't reach this level of quality until Dishonored, or maybe even Prey. Now back to the other one.
Unfortunately though, great video game remakes like these are more the exception rather than the rule. Recently we got a remake of Final Fantasy VII, and while a lot of people like the game, I can't stand it at all. The gameplay is fine, but it's not like an action game classic or anything. Even for an ARPG, I don't find its combat anywhere near as satisfying as Kingdom Hearts 2, which to be fair, Kingdom Hearts clearly was the inspiration for it. I mean, same director and all. Damn, it's bad enough you have to ruin your own series, you have to mess with the most famous JRPG of all time too. But yeah, this is a reimagining of the original Final Fantasy VII, but damn, I don't remember the original Final Fantasy VII being padded out with so much filler. I remember the Midgard section of the game finished about 6 hours in. So why is this game nothing but the first 6 hours of the original game stretched to 5 times the length? The Midgard section of Final Fantasy VII didn't need expanding to this degree, because it means that the remake goes at the speed of molasses. Sure, you can say it's different, it doesn't need to be the exact same as the original, which I agree, but you're shooting your own game in the foot long term when you're spending in total 90 hours minimum to tell the entire story of Final Fantasy VII. More game is not always a good thing. Sometimes less is more. Sure, the game ends in a way where it might take a different direction to the original Final Fantasy VII, and the sequels might take a lot of liberties from the main story, but who knows how far they'll actually go with making it different from the original. The trailer for Part 2 shows the scenes of Cloud and Sephiroth in the past as partners, as well as the Cloud and Zack parts from Crisis Core, so it seems to still be taking parts from the Final Fantasy VII compilation canon. I'd still argue that even if Part 2 and 3 were theoretically amazing games, the first part of this trilogy would be an extreme slog to get through, with filler up the ass.
Ass.
The original Final Fantasy VII is a classic for a reason. The game has so much heart put into it, the cast were all great, and the story was really well told. I've replayed Final Fantasy VII a ton of times, and I still don't get tired of it. The remake in comparison, I can see the intentions behind it, and it just makes me sad. I know this is all subjective, but the Final Fantasy VII remake is among one of the most disappointing titles I have ever experienced. I genuinely believe it's a case where a remake that carried over the story but updated the visuals would have went over really well. Even if you did keep it turn-based, like Dragon Quest XI sold 6.5 million units worldwide, if you include both versions of the game, so it's not like there isn't an audience for turn-based combat. In comparison, the Final Fantasy VII remake sold only 5 million worldwide, so can't really say the change in gameplay style was worth it. So where does that leave us when two of the biggest games that were announced in June were remakes of two great games, Resident Evil 4 and The Last of Us? It's a difficult situation to talk about because you could make an argument both games don't really need a remake. The Last of Us Remastered goes for less than 15 quid a lot of the time, and while the graphical leap is impressive in the remake, the original Last of Us really is no slouch in the looks department, and its story still holds up incredibly well. However, this may surprise you, but there really is some benefit to remaking The Last of Us in my opinion. Sure, when you talk about The Last of Us, you can talk about how great the characters are and how well told the story is, but a lot of people tend to neglect the actual gameplay of the game. It's an over-the-shoulder third-person shooter. That's all there really is to it. I mean, it's competent. I'm not really fond of the gunplay in the Uncharted games, and I think The Last of Us is only slightly better. This isn't helped by the AI of the game being nowhere near as smart as the demo made it out to be. In fact, it was kind of false advertising. I know a lot of people don't play the game for the gameplay anyway, but if there was one thing in The Last of Us 2 that improved on the first one, it was the actual gameplay. The AI was a ton smarter, and the stealth and gunplay actually had to be approached more carefully. Whereas in the original game, the AI aren't much smarter than your average Uncharted enemy, not reacting realistically at all. For example, running at you without any care, even though they should be more cautious that somebody with a gun's in front of them, but they run at them anyway. One idiot. So yeah, with better graphics, mocap, and AI to improve the experience, The Last of Us Remake looks like it will objectively make the older version obsolete, even if it doesn't seem like much is being changed. Improvements are improvements, and that can't be denied here. Are $70 games pushing it for a remake of a game that hasn't really aged poorly in of itself? A bit. Are $70 games pushing it? A bit. Gaming isn't affordable for a lot of people nowadays, which sucks because I'm sure there's a lot of people that will want to play it on release, and the steep price might be a turnoff, but at the end of the day, it's a game you've played before anyway. I was going to replay The Last of Us this year, but when I heard of the improvements with the remake, I thought, why not just play the better version? There's a chance the story might be messed with or something, but it seems like it's a one-for-one cutscene recreation, so I doubt it. So, what The Last of Us Remake has done is take the model from The Last of Us 2 and is essentially painting The Last of Us Part 1 over it, which isn't inherently a bad thing. As I mentioned, it seems like an objective improvement.
Let's get a move on.
But there are examples where this hasn't always worked. As much as I like Yakuza Kiwami 1 and 2, they aren't objective improvements over the games they're remaking. In fact, they actually bring problems of their own, such as the loss in the original game's atmosphere. The Majima Everywhere system flanderizes Majima's character, and Kiwami 2's combat being one of the weaker combat systems in my opinion. Still decent though. So where does that lead us with the Resident Evil 4 remake? Personally, I think it's the opposite of The Last of Us remake. That you can't guarantee an objective improvement. In fact, you're borderline guaranteeing an entirely different experience from the original Resident Evil 4, more so than the remake of Resident Evil 2 was to the original, because the heart of Resident Evil 2 was still in the remake, and the fact that they were both survival horror games was still at the core of both of the experiences. But Resident Evil 4?
Somehow I thought you'd be a little older.
It's already changed the medium of third-person shooters. What is there left to do with it? I get it. Some people find Resident Evil 4 tough to control because, well, tank controls, right? You could argue that it's an objective improvement, but it really isn't. The areas and enemies were designed around the controls of that game. Precision aiming was much more important since the game had to accommodate for you standing still to aim. And guess what? Even with all of this, Resident Evil 4 is one of the greatest and most fun experiences you'll ever have with a game. If you really have trouble with how it plays, there's an easy mode. Set it to that and take the time to learn how to play the game. It really isn't demanding and is extremely satisfying in a way a lot of over-the-top third-person shooters just aren't. Like, Resident Evil 4 is balls to the walls insane. You can perform wrestling moves on enemies in this third-person shooter. I don't see The Last of Us letting you do that, even though it would have made the game 10 times better. Resident Evil 4 is an action game first and a horror game second, and that's fine. It always was fine. The only people who cared were the ones that didn't know how to have fun. I don't mind that Metal Gear Rising is an over-the-top action game despite being a huge Metal Gear fan, because the game is awesome and has some of the best boss fights in a game I've ever played. So of course, Resident Evil 4 isn't going to bother me because it's quote-unquote untrue to the originals. But here we are in 2022 with the announcement of the remake, and I just don't see myself enjoying it as much. We really haven't seen a lot of it, but based on the tone, it seems to be more of a survival horror instead of the over-the-top action crazy game that we know. Which I have to ask, why did they miss the appeal of what made the original game so great? Original Resident Evil 4 was campy as hell. There's no way you can remake the plot of Resident Evil 4 and have me take the character of Salazar seriously.
You're nothing but an extra in my script. So don't get too carried away.
He was one of the best parts of the original. This tiny man who was trading quips with Leon. It was great. It gave the game character and a certain charm to it. Strip that away and what are you left with? Resident Evil 4's story at its core isn't a very interesting one. In fact, it's very basic. It was the tone that carried a lot of it, and with the slowed down pacing it might be going for instead of the fast pacing of the original game style, I have to wonder if the game will even be for me. Don't get me wrong, I'm going to get it anyway. Any game boasting to be a remake of Resident Evil 4 has my attention automatically, but I just don't really care for the direction it's going in, honestly. I really want to be proven wrong on it. I really do, but I'm not setting myself up for disappointment on this one. Remakes of video games have let me down before, so what makes this one different? Resident Evil 4 may be a great game, but it has some huge shoes to fill, and that will never not be hanging over this game for the rest of its development. Thanks for watching. Please help us out by hitting that subscribe button to be notified as soon as our content comes out. We have some great ideas for the future, and it'd be much appreciated from us. Good night, everyone.